Hi, I'm on Quinette Crosby, and I'm filling in for Rock Newman. This evening on The Rock Newman Show, I chat with actor, author, television producer, and director Ted Lange. We'll discuss his history on the small screen and his new stage play, George Washington's Boy. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm on Quinette Crosby, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Best known for his role as Isaac Washington, the bartender on The Love Boat, Ted Lange is a small screen staple. And with directing credits for hit sitcoms like Moesha and Mr. Box Office, his influence spans decades. He joins me now to talk about how he's maneuvered through the TV world and his latest project, a stage play entitled George Washington's Boy. Ted, welcome to the show. It's wonderful to have you here.
You're so fine, Aphenia.
Stop it.
Hey, baby, you're looking good.
And so
happy
are you.
Happy to be here.
Happy to have you. That smile is still as wonderful and bright as ever.
Thank you.
So you have such an impressive vault of work, and we're going to talk about your directing and your writing. But we want to take it back a little bit to Oakland.
Okay, wherever you want
to
go.
Well, we're going to start in Oakland.
That's where I'll be.
Okay. We're going to start in Oakland.
Okay.
That's where you were born and raised, Oakland, California.
Yes.
I know a little something about Oakland.
Yes,
myself.
You do,
that
don't
was
you?
My old stomping ground.
Yeah.
And, you know, let's talk about, when did you decide that you wanted to act?
Well, I was in junior high school, and I did a Shakespearean play in the ninth grade in Oakland. And then when I got to high school, they wanted me to do auto shop. But my first choice was drama. And I got very lucky in that within the first week, they were rehearsing a play in the auditorium. And I ended up on the inside. They told me to get away from the door, and I went in instead of going out. And I saw them rehearsing a play, and that was it. So I went back to my counselor. I said, I don't want to do auto shop. I want to do drama. And he said, well, you got, you know, your third year, you'll do drama. I said, well, no, I want to do it now. Do auto shop my third year. So they switched it around. And I was very fortunate in that the drama teacher was very progressive. His name is Tom Wayne, W-H-A-Y-N-E. And he became like my mentor. He and his wife, they took an interest in me. And we're still friends to this day. He's 91 years old. And I see him all the time. I keep him abreast of what I do. I send him my plays, like George Washington's Boy. I send him a copy of that. And I let him know that we're gonna be doing it here in Falls Church on Saturday. So he's always mentored me. And I just thought I was an actor. And I would watch him, and he would direct our plays, but he would also write sketches and stuff like that. And so he instilled in me not only about acting,
but to write.
But to write, to direct, you know, not to, to expand your horizons, not be limited just by one thing.
All right, so you go home, you tell your parents, hey, think I'm gonna be an actor. What was the response?
Well, my father was an actor in Los Angeles. He's the problem, he didn't really do that much television, because this was in the 50s and the early 60s. He was very fair-skinned. So back at that time, if you were a black person and you were on television, they wanted you to be black. They wanted you to look black. Okay, so, but he was high yellow. So he didn't work that much on television or in the movies, but he worked on stage.
Okay.
So I remember telling him when I'm 17, I said, I'm going to, Dad, I think I want to go for this. And he goes, go for it.
Really?
Yeah, yeah, go for it. And the same thing I said to my mother, I said to my mom, I said, you know, I've been watching Dad, and, you know, I had this success in these high school plays. And I said, I think I want to try and do that. And so my mother says, well, you know, Teddy, there's room at the top. It's the bottom that's crowded. So go for it. So that was the kind of, I had the backing of my parents and plus my drama teacher. And those three people are the ones that counted in my life. Now, there were a lot of people that said, you know, you're not that funny.
Right. Why don't you be a teacher, right?
Why don't you teach instead of trying to have a career? Because there's only Sydney and Cosby and a couple of Greg Morris. You're not going to make it. And I said, well, I'm going to give it a shot. Mm-hmm. And that's what I did. So the thing about it is I had three very important people in my life that gave me inspiration. And with those three people, I kept that with me as I made my journey. Mm-hmm. And so there were a lot of naysayers, but you don't listen to them.
But
really,
the three pivotal people in your life, I mean, to have that foundation is incredible because not everybody has that.
No.
Okay, so then you leave Oakland, then where do you go?
Well, I did theater in the Bay Area. Mm-hmm. And I did a play called Big Time Buck White with Oscar Brown Jr. And before that, I did Romeo and Juliet. We did a black-white version in 1968.
Okay, how did that go over?
Well, the audiences enjoyed it. The critics, there was a whole thing about black people doing Shakespeare at the time. Mm-hmm. And then to make it political by making it black-white, Juliet white and Romeo black, it stepped on a few toes because they weren't ready, but they had to get ready,
right.
You know, and that production made them get ready. That also opened the door for me because at first, usually they say when you're going to do Shakespeare, you do Othello, mm-hmm. and basically that's it, Titus Andronicus. There's a part of Aaron in that. And there's one or two other little parts for black people, but we were, this whole thing about diversification and colorblind casting, mm-hmm. we were doing that in 1968. So it was, I came in knowing that I could only bind myself.
Right.
You know, you could try to bind me, but if I didn't listen to that, I would.
You're gonna make your own way.
I would make my own way. Okay. And so I did that, and out of that, I met Oscar Brown Jr. And we did a musical called Big Time Buck White, which eventually ended up on Broadway. Now, I didn't go. I went to L.A., which is a whole nother adventure.
Why wouldn't you take the opportunity to be on Broadway?
It wasn't me. It was Oscar Brown's wife.
Oh.
Her name was Jean Pace. And, you know, this is the great thing about show business is some people are going to like you. Some
right.
people are not going to like you. And the people that don't like you, you don't listen to. And the people that like you, you forge a relationship. Mm-hmm. Jean Pace was not crazy about me. Oscar loved me, but Oscar was married to Jean. And what Jean said went.
Mm-hmm.
So when they went to New York, I did not go. And I remember talking to my mother, and she said, listen, Teddy, his loss.
Mm-hmm.
And so you go, you know, I didn't think about it that way. His loss.
Mm-hmm.
My mother instilled in me that you're your own person, and that's not going to make or break you. You can still have a career. You're just not going to be on Broadway in that show.
Right. You're going to take a different path.
And you may get to Broadway. Who knows? You may not.
And you did get to Broadway,
and
too.
And I did get to Broadway. But it's very important sometimes when you're at your lowest that someone, you know, gives you a little nudge.
Mm-hmm.
And I was very fortunate with my mom.
Mine too.
Mothers, is that right?
Yes, mothers are our hearts.
Yes, they are.
So See? You go to L.A.
So I go to L.A. and in L.A. I'm trying to get some work on television. This is around the time of Mod Squad,
mm-hmm.
and a couple of other things. And
not a lot of opportunities for black actors during that time, right?
Mod Squad was just about
it.
You know, I think Julia was
Link?
Another one.
Was it Link was the character on
yeah,
Mod Squad?
Yeah, but you know, so they would rotate three stories. So one would be with the little blonde girl, and then the mm-hmm. next one would be with the guy, and then the next one would be a story with Link, and mm-hmm. so you knew they were gonna be black parts.
Right.
couldn't get arrested, and everyone said, well, you have to go to New York. You have to go to New York. You don't have a New York credit. If you get a New York credit, you know, then it'll be easier.
Mm-hmm.
So eventually that's what I did, is I went from auditioning around Los Angeles for theater, not for television. Couldn't crack television to save my life. And ended up in the musical Hair.
Now, a little known musical Hair.
Yeah,
that's
and,
cool.
And stood on the stage and sang Let the Sun Shine In with no clothes on. Can't do that now, but I did it back then when I was a young man.
But a huge hit, and you can sing?
I sing like, I tell people I sing like Rex Harrison. I do not sing like Stevie Wonder.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
So obviously, it was good enough.
Yeah, and so we had fun though. Mm-hmm. It was a wonderful time. It was the '60s. The show was a revolution in itself because it was telling people about coming together.
Yeah.
In a time when we had the Vietnam War, mm-hmm. when we had a lot of dissension. Hey, much like now. But it was about us all coming together and looking forward to the future and what we could do in the future mm-hmm. to make a better world. And that brought me into New York, and then from out of there I did some other theater. I did Ain't Supposed to Die a Natural Death with Melvin Van Peebles.
Oh.
And that was wonderful because that's when I started playwriting.
Mm-hmm.
Seriously started getting into playwriting because I took a play to Melvin and I said, Melvin, I wrote this play. I'd love you to look at it. He says, how many acts? I said, it's a one-act play. He says, I'm not looking at it. I said, why? He says, you write a two-act play, and then I'll look at it.
Hmm.
Why? Why a two-act, not a one? He says, because as much heartache goes into a two-act as a one-act, and you might as well have a full-length play. So I only wrote one one-act play. The rest of my I've written 25 plays. All my plays are full-length plays, and that's because of Melvin. But
he's the father of Mario.
Mario Van Peebles, mm-hmm. sweet mm-hmm. back's badass song, and he had a play on Broadway called Ain't Supposed to Die a Natural Death,
mm-hmm.
and one of the actors that I understudied was Garrett Morris, who is now on Two Broke Girls. I've known Garrett. Garrett celebrated his 80th birthday.
Oh.
We've been friends for 42 years.
Wow.
And Bill Duke, who's the director, I understudied mm-hmm. him. And there were a lot of notable black actors on Broadway at that time, and I was with them. And that was a really strong confidence
yeah.
builder because they appreciated my talent. And told me so,
mm-hmm.
you know, and this is back in the days when you looked out for each other. So like if you went up for a part and you didn't get it or you didn't feel you did an audition well, you would call me and say, hey, Ted, listen, go over to so-and-so.
Oh, see.
Yeah.
We had each other's back.
Me, Philip Michael Thomas, and Ben Vereen. And I don't know if you know, Philip Michael Thomas was from Miami Vice.
Oh, yeah.
And Ben Vereen. The three of us hung out. Well, Philip did a movie called Book of Numbers.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how he found out about Book of Numbers is I auditioned. I knew it didn't go well. So I called and said, Philip, go over. They're doing Book of Numbers. I think you're right for the thing. Check it out. So we looked out for it.
Yeah.
Ben Vereen, when I directed my first Love Boat episode, I said, Ben, why don't you guest star on our show? He goes, I'm a guest star when you direct. He says, so I went to the producers and they finally gave me, after 4 years, they gave me a directing assignment.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, you know, we did three stories on Love Boat. I said, this third story, I think, could be a black story. And they go, well, yeah, who do you see as the guy? I said, Ben Vereen. They went, Ben Vereen, if you could get Ben Vereen, we'll make it a black story. So I called up Ben. I said, hey, man, remember? He says, I'm there.
See.
And it was like that. We looked out for each other.
A beautiful thing. All right, so before the Love Boat, That's My Mama. There was a lot of drama around you getting That's My Mama, right?
That's My Mama. That's My Mama was the first time you had a street character doing comedy.
Mm-hmm.
So I was playing an 18-year-old kid, but because he was street, and prior to that, every time you saw a street character, the guy was either a pimp or a thief or something like that. So we got a lot of mail that said, well, you know, take that guy off the thing because he's being a pimp. And they said, no, he's never said anything about being a pimp.
Mm-hmm.
He's a street guy that goes into a barbershop in Washington, D.C., by the way.
Mm-hmm.
And So they tried to eliminate the character, but I was getting my laughs.
So first, describe for folks who may not know, what was That's My Mama all about? There was Clifton Davis.
Clifton Davis owned a barbershop.
Yeah.
And Teresa Merritt was his mama. And the barbershop was connected to the house, and his best friend was a postman named Earl. And what would happen is Earl and Clifton would get into trouble. And then just before the act break, they'd get out of trouble and everything looked fine. And then my character, Junior, who was a street character who kept his ear to the ground, would come in and he'd say, "Ooh, wee." And they go, "Well, Junior, what's up, what's up?" So, "You know how you guys got into trouble and everything was all messed up?" They go, "Yeah." And, "You know how you guys fixed it and everything seems right?" They go, "Yeah." I said, "No, man, you guys really messed up now." And then they go to commercial, and that was the deal. So my character always turned the story so that just when they thought they made it, I came in and told them they didn't make it.
But you almost didn't get the part because they were thinking about eliminating it, right?
Yeah, so, well, what happened was they, I did a screen test. There's three of us. We did screen tests. And at the time, I was going to the American Film Institute, and I was studying film directing. And so and this is the way Hollywood is. They said, "Okay, you're in. We like it. You're good." Then someone said, "Well, street character." And so they called me back, "You're out." And this went back and forth. "You're in. You're out. You're in. You're out." And finally, they said, "You're out." So I go, "Well, tell them thank you anyway, but I'm going to receive the James Cagney Fellowship Award from the American Film Institute for directing." And so they had a big show on CBS where they honored James Cagney, and all of these high, heavyweight people were in the room, and I was in the room, and they acknowledged me as budding talent. So I stood up, I took a bow. And the next day they called and they said, "We want him in the show."
So the big wigs were watching, right?
They were watching. And they said, "Well, who the hell is this guy? And why is he getting an award? And so, and how come we don't have him on the show?" And so that's the day they put me on the show. They gave me four lines. And my whole deal was to get five laughs. If I have four lines, I'm going to try to get five laughs. So that's why you saw him kind of move the way he moved and talk the way he talked. And, you know, so I was using everything I could to stay on the show.
How old were you then?
I was about 25.
Oh, wow.
But I was playing 18, shaved off my beard, my mustache and everything, and I looked like I was 17, 18 years old.
Were there times when you had to take roles that you didn't feel that great about? I mean, you talk about playing some pimps, a pimp or two.
Yeah. No, I never felt bad about any of that because there were no roles.
Right. You gotta eat.
I just wanted to be in show business, you know. Yeah. So what's the part? Well, the part is that a pimp. I could do that. Well, the part is a doctor. I could do that. Well, the guy's a janitor. I could do, you know, whatever it was. I just wanted to work, and I wanted to, you know, like you might do something with some actors that you admire. I wanted to be on stage with those guys, or I wanted to be in a movie with those guys. So at that point, it wasn't a question. You know, you knew, like if there were some things that were like off color or not exact, sometimes when you're in the mix, you can say to them, you know, rather than, "Can I say this?" And usually they would go, "Oh yeah, okay, that's better. Yeah, try that." So sometimes from the inside, you can maneuver in such a way that makes it all right. So like when I was on Love Boat, I wanted to be in the opening of the show and then in the closing of the show. And they just wanted me to be the bartender in the middle of the show.
The black guy behind the bar.
The black guy behind the bar. And the only time you see him is when he's shoving a drink in front of you and listening to your problems. And I said, "Well, how come the white people are all in the front of the show and I'm not with them?"
Because they're white?
Because, well, they wouldn't say that. They wouldn't say that. They would say, "Well, you're the bartender. Why would you be in the lobby greeting people?" I said, "Well, why is the captain there? He should be on the bridge. Well, why is Doc there? He should be in sick bay. If they can be there, why can't I be there?" And so we eventually hashed it out, and the executive producer, Aaron Spelling, talked to the writers, and they said, "Hey, put them in there."
So did Love Boat come right after That's My Mama?
No, I did a series in between called Mr. T and Tina.
Okay.
With Pat Morita, who became the Karate Kid mentor.
Yeah.
And we did a show called Mr. T and Tina, and it wasn't a strongly written comedy. Mm. So when we did it, there were times when there was a lull, mm-hmm. and the laughs weren't achieved. However, when I came on and I did my thing, I got my laughs. Mm-hmm. So the show went up. And then when I left, the show went back down
what
again.
What was your character?
I was the janitor. I was a maintenance custodian of mm-hmm. a Chicago high-rise. And so I'd come in, and Pat Morita and I, we had a great chemistry. And that was the thing about when you're in a television show or on stage, is the chemistry between the actors.
Right.
And so Pat and I, we connected. And the girl was called Mr. T and Tina. Tina and Pat did not have the same chemistry. So they were trying to figure out how to find the thing for them. Whereas when I came on, he and I clicked immediately. Mm-hmm. Part of it is because Pat thinks he's black. and I acknowledge that, you know. But we had a rhythm. There was a rhythm that he had. And so we did some very funny stuff. And after that show, they wanted to do a series with me and Pat. For CBS, they said no, because the show, Mr. T and Tina, only lasted 4 weeks. So they mm-hmm. said, no, we don't want to do that. So the producer, Jimmy Comack, said, give me some holding money for this black kid, because I think he's funny, and mm-hmm. I think he's going to go places. And they said, well, we have to think about it. Meanwhile, Love Boat comes along, and they said, ABC is very hot on you because of this T and Tina show. Do you get seasick? Yeah. I go, no, I don't get seasick. Because what are you going to say? Do you ride a horse? Yeah, I ride a horse. Can you be on a motorcycle? Yes. Whatever it is, I can do it.
Right.
You know. So he said, well, we're thinking of doing this thing and we need a bartender. I said, okay, well, what do you want me to read? Nothing. You just want to know, do you get seasick? No. Okay, fine. And so I went away. Then what happened was, we're getting ready to shoot the pilot mm-hmm. of Love Boat, and at the same time, I'm waiting to hear if I can have my own TV series for CBS, but they have to give me what's called holding money so that I don't do Love Boat.
So right there, what is your psyche like going these ups and downs, these peaks and valleys? How do you get through all this?
Well, you're not, that doesn't happen until after. Mm-hmm. You right at the moment when you're in the heat of the moment, you're saying, geez, I hope this TV series comes through that I get to star in. Or you're saying, if that doesn't happen, I got this Love Boat thing to fall back on. Mm-hmm. Well, let's see. And then you work with your agent. And I told my agent at the time, I said, the Love Boat thing isn't that good. He says, well, what do you mean? I said, well, I'm in the opening of the pilot. I have one scene, and I stand around at the end of the show. I don't say anything.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, well, listen, Ted, have you ever been to Mexico? Mm-mm. No. Have you ever been on a cruise? No. He says, well, they want to pay you $10,000 mm-hmm. for a vacation. Take the gig.
Right.
So I said, oh, if you look at it like that, okay. So, and that's what we did. And so what happened was, it was 1 hour mm-hmm. that I had to either take the Love Boat thing or wait for the TV sitcom for CBS with Comack. And my agent said, look, this isn't coming through. Take the Love Boat gigs. Mm-hmm. I said, okay. Took the Love Boat gig. An hour later, they called up and said, okay, we got the holding money for you. I said, well, you're an hour late, buddy. We're gone. We're out of here. And that's what happened. So, but you never know where, you know, fate is going to turn.
Right. Stressful?
Well, I think when you're young, you don't think about this. I didn't think about the stress.
What about, I mean, paying bills? Were you able to?
I didn't have any bills. Are you kidding me?
Where were you living?
I lived like a Spartan, man. I had a studio apartment. You know what I mean? Or I'd go crash at your house or something mm-hmm. like that. So
you were couch hopping if you needed to.
Oh, yeah. And I had a car. I had a 1954 Chevy that when you stop for gas, you stop for oil. You know, and it was a four-door, and three doors didn't work. Uh-huh. You had to climb in the back passenger side and hop over the seat. So I didn't, you know, if I made $2,000, I could stretch that for a long time.
Did you ever have to call home?
No, I didn't actually. Because there are some very nice ladies in Los Angeles. And they treated me
really well.
Yeah, yeah. I used to do a thing like if I met you, I'd take you out to dinner if I was flush.
Mm-hmm.
I'd take you out to dinner and we go to some nice place and I'd say, I may not be flush in a month. So I'm going to ask you a favor. And you say, well, what's the favor? I said, will you cook dinner for me if I need dinner? And usually girls say, yeah, sure. Mm-hmm. That's not a, because this is a wonderful dinner. So, yeah, well, I'm flush now, you know. And so that's what would happen is, you know, and you had.
Yeah, they call that a hustle.
That, well, I didn't pimp them, but we did have some fun, you know. But and that's the way it was with the guys. Art Evans and Glenn Turman are two of my pals, and we made a pact to look out for each other. So if things got really tough, I'd crash at Art's house. And then I'd go to your house and have dinner.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean?
Right.
It was like we were all in this together because black folks in Hollywood were up. It was a war. Because we're trying to get into the system, and the system is they're not happy about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, they're not giving us our due. So you had to make alliances with each other so that we could crack this system to have it come to where it is today.
But were you all showing up pretty much for the same roles in auditions?
Yeah,
for the same
sure. There were, I call it the bench. You'd see the same guys mm-hmm. that would get, there would be certain guys that weren't ready, that would have to go back to class, that would have to, you know, that were either too tall or too short or too dark or too light for the part. And you'd end up with maybe about six or seven guys that were always up for the same part. And sometimes it would be five guys because two of those guys got gigs somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
So you start, and so what would happen is you'd look out for each other if you knew that, oh, I got this gig over here. Like Glenn Turman got a gig in a movie called Inkwell. Mm-hmm. And he said to me, hey, Ted, I got to go do this job. And they want to do a play with Yolanda King, Martin Luther King's daughter, in North Carolina at the Black Theater Festival. Would you do that for me? Yeah, because we looked out for each other. And I got to meet Martin Luther King's daughter. I got to meet Coretta Scott King in my life. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So that mentality isn't always around now.
Right.
Because now it's more, I deserve this, not you. You know, give me. But when we were coming up, when I was coming up, we as thespians together in the mm-hmm. fight, we looked out for each other because you can't play every part, you know?
Yeah.
And which led me to when I wasn't working, I started writing plays like George Washington's Boy
mm-hmm.
because I wanted to work. And so I wrote, I originally wrote this for myself. There's a character called William Lee who was George Washington's favorite slave. And so I wrote that for myself. I said, okay, when things go down, I'm gonna do this play, George Washington's Boy. And I started researching it and I found out I was too old to play William Lee. So, and if you wanna see it, you can come to Falls Church, Episcopal Church this Saturday. But I found when I started researching a play for me was like playing a part. So like if I'm gonna play Romeo,
mm-hmm.
I gotta look at Verona in 1571. That's research, so that I know what the clothes look like, I know what the character's thinking, I know what the environment that he comes from.
So writing plays, that came about because does the phone stop ringing? I mean, we didn't talk enough about Love Boat. I think folks obviously remember you most as Isaac. And so that show lasted, what, 10 years or
10
so?
10 years.
During that time, how was your stay there? You said there was a little bit of back and forth as
you
behind the bar so you could be front and center with the rest of the
right,
ensemble.
And we did that. And here's the deal. Aaron Spelling did not like his actors to do guest shots and on other shows. He wanted them on his show.
Mm-hmm.
And I got an offer for Roots. And I said, Aaron, these guys, they're not cutting me any slack here. I got a chance to do Roots. Mm-hmm. It had blown up and they were doing the second part of Roots. And I said, and they wanted me to play Alex Haley's father. And so I said, come on, you guys. He said, whoa, wait, what's the problem? I said, well, you know, I'm not in the beginning. We'll take care of that. And so what I did was I learned that negotiation mm-hmm. is imagination. Now, some people don't understand that. Some people say, well, if you can't pay me my money, I'm not doing mm-hmm. the part. That's not show business. Show business is negotiation is imagination. First of all, as a black artist, they're not going to pay you the same as a white artist. They're just not going to do it. Mm-hmm. You know, I was talking to some actors that have done some extraordinary work. They got a tenth of what the white co-star would get in the same movie and carry the same kind of weight.
So the racism, was it more subtle or was it ever overt?
It's never overt. Mm-hmm. None of it's overt, because then you could call them on it. Mm-hmm. It's not overt at all. You're going out scratching your head going, wait a minute, what was, you know? No, it's never overt, but you can feel that something's off.
Right.
You know when something's off. You know when you're sitting in the restaurant and everybody else gets served and you've been there 45 minutes and they haven't picked up the menus from you yet. Mm. You know, well, something's not right here. You know, so that's the way Hollywood is. Hollywood is, but you got to, there are ways of getting around that. So, for instance, when I did Love Boat, they had to re-sign us for the next couple of years. Mm-hmm. And we made these deals. Now, there's a thing called Favorite Nations. Do you know what that is?
No.
Favorite Nations?
No.
Well, let me give you a little lesson. Favorite Nations is every actor gets the same. Mm-hmm. So, for instance, when Ron Howard did Happy Days, mm-hmm. he had Favorite Nations. So that if anybody blew up bigger than him and they wanted to pay this other actor more than him, they couldn't. They had to pay the actor the same amount that they paid him. So Henry Winkler
blew up. The Fonz blew up. And
so they said, we're going to give you all of this money, Henry.
Yeah.
And then Ron said,
hello.
Hey, we got Favorite Nations. And they go, oh, man, okay, yeah. So they gave Ron the same deal. When there was a show called Chips with Eric Estrada mm-hmm. and Larry, they gave, Eric Estrada had the same amount that Larry had, white cop,
Latino
cop, mm-hmm. right? So who blew up?
Eric Estrada.
You know? So the studio bought Eric a Rolls Royce as a thank you. And Larry said, hey.
Right.
You got to give me a Rolls Royce. He said, so what I did was when they renegotiated the contract, I had Bernie Coppell, Fred Grandy, and myself, we were on the same tier. Mm. But I knew they were going to give me less. Mm-hmm. Now, they're not going to tell me they're going to give me less, but that's what they're going to do. So I said, listen, they said, so how much money do you want for the next couple of years, Ted? I said, I want Favorite Nations. And they go, well, no. Well, how much money do you want?
Yeah.
I said, I want Favorite Nations. I'm happy to be here. Whatever you give those guys, I'm happy with.
Right.
You know? And so they go,
were they surprised you knew about Favorite Nations?
Yeah, and that's what you do. You talk to everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Old timers will give you all the information. So I said, kid, Favorite Nations, okay? And so that's what happened is I got Favorite Nations.
Wow.
But now here's the deal. At the same time, I wanted to direct, okay? So they did like this. They came back to me and they said, hey, Ted, you got Favorite Nations? I go, yeah. They said, but here's the deal. You also want to direct? I go, yeah. They said, well, we'll keep you at Favorite Nations, the same as everybody else, if you don't direct. If you do direct, we're going to give you a little less than the other guys, but when you direct, you'll be brought up to the same position as them, mm-hmm. salary-wise. So you'll be working twice as hard without the benefit
right.
of the thing. And I said, yeah, but I really want to direct it. Can't you? They said, no, can't do it.
Because they knew that's what you wanted to do.
They knew, that's how they get you.
Yeah.
You know? keep your thing secret.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Keep whatever your deal is secret. But that's so, but I took that deal because, it, and it later held me in good stead. I was making so much money. I was making so much money.
And what were you doing? What were you doing with the money? Were you saving it? Were you?
Well, let me tell you one thing. I like to mess with my coworkers. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we went to Hong Kong, and I told the producers, because if you went on a ship back in those days, you found the rooms were really smaller than they were on the television show. And you'd be, boy, man, these rooms aren't big like they are on TV. So we went to Hong Kong, and I said to to the boss, I said, I want a suite when we get to Hong Kong, because we're going to be in Hong Kong for 2 weeks. I want a suite. And they said, I'm not giving you a suite. Now, they had to get me a room, but they weren't going to get me a suite. They said, we're not giving you a suite. What are you, crazy? And I said, no, I want a suite. They said, no, that's too expensive. I said, just pay whatever it is you're going to pay me, and I'll pick up the balance, because I was making Grand Theft Dough. Mm-hmm. I'll pick up the balance, but I do want a suite. Mm-hmm. So they said, oh, okay, you're going to pay for the, I go, yeah. So we get to Hong Kong. Now, Fred Grandy, who played Gopher, I used to tease him all the time. So we're in Hong Kong, and I say to the guys, I say, come on down to my room, and we'll have a drink before we go out to dinner. Now, I had a full bar. I had a piano in the room.
Oh,
I had a view of two sides of Hong Kong. And so they come down to my room, and they look around, and they go, because they're staying in like a little, you know, closet almost. And they're going, hey, man, how'd you get this? And I said, what do you mean? This is, you got a suite.
They're like, you don't have a suite either?
Yeah, that's what I said. We all got suites. They said, we didn't get a suite. I said, oh, quit jiving. They said, what do you mean? We didn't get a suite. I said, do you think they would give the black guy a suite and not give you guys a suite? And they go, yes. So Fred calls, he leaves, and he calls his manager. He says, Ted Lange's got a suite, and I want a suite. You get me a suite. So the manager goes, and he comes back, and he said, Ted Lange is paying for the other part of the suite.
The upgrade.
Yeah, so he comes to me and he says, so, I know what you did, Ted. I said, what do you mean? He says, you're paying for the other half of the suite. I said, where'd you hear that? He said, that's what the company told me. I said, well, if you want to believe that, it's okay with me. But I ain't paying nothing.
So some of the big names that came through, I'm going to throw some names out at you. Mm-hmm. Tom Hanks, you said you knew when he walked through that he was going to be a big deal.
Yeah, he had magic. He had the magic. You can see Billy Crystal, he had the magic. Mm-hmm. Martin Short. You could see when a person came on if they had something, I think.
Describe for those youngins that don't know what Love Boat was all about.
Love Boat was an escapist thing. It was beautiful women getting on the boat with a problem. Beautiful guys getting on the boat with a problem. Charactery guys and women getting on the boat, and everybody had a problem. And what happens is, by taking the cruise, you figure out how to solve your problem. Mm-hmm. So that when you got off the boat, it was a happy ending. Mm-hmm. Okay? There were three stories that would interweave. And at some point, one of those stories would end up in a bar. And you'd meet this very, hopefully, charming bartender.
With that smile, come on.
Yeah, well, that was the deal.
And your trademark.
And my trademark was that.
And you got to explain why you do that, too.
Okay. But I would listen to your problem. I'd say, well, you know, if you're having problems with your girlfriend, why don't you buy her a rose, you know? And the guy goes, a rose? I never thought of that. That was the writing.
Right.
Okay. So the guy would go out and get a rose, and the girl would say, I love you. Thank you for the rose. Mm-hmm. And that's what our show was. Our show was kind of like all of these different things coming together. And there was a certain simplicity to it, but it was also fun because it was comedy.
Right.
And it was a chance for you to escape. And then what they found is if you lived in the East Coast during the winter, our ratings went through the roof because you had girls in bikinis and...
escapism.
Yeah, it was total escapism.
Diane Carroll.
Diane Carroll first of all, she's very, very beautiful. Mm-hmm. And she was my first romantic love interest on screen. And
your first kiss.
My first kiss on screen, and I kissed her about 15 times.
Unnecessarily.
No, it was necessary because we kept messing up.
Yeah, you kept messing up because you kept wanting to kiss her.
That's right, and she didn't figure that out until about the 14th take, so then I said, okay.
And then Janet Jackson was a love interest. She was only 17 years old.
17 years old.
You were 30. Talk about that.
Yeah, well, the deal is this. Is I said, this is not going to look good for a...
Not a good look.
A 30-year-old guy to be with us. And they said, don't worry. We're going to dress her down. We're going to make her look a little more sophisticated. I said, but she's a kid. Mm-hmm. And so I asked her one time, I said, Janet, was I your first screen kiss? Because I thought I could brag about that. She said, no, you were the second. So who was the first? He said Todd Bridges, because she had done a different strokes, mm-hmm. and even though they were kids, they ended up kissing. So I said, oh, and so my kids didn't know. I remember this. My oldest son went to a Janet Jackson concert, mm-hmm. and I said, well, tell her I said hi. And he said, Dad, you don't know Janet Jackson. I said, no, I know her. I said, if you get backstage, tell her I said hi. So he went to the concert. They got backstage. They saw Janet. They all got to meet her. Mm-hmm. And he came home then. I said, did you see? He said, yeah, did you tell her? I said, no, I didn't tell her hi from you. He said, because you don't know her. And so about maybe a month later, we lived in L.A. in the Valley. Mm-hmm. I was going to the movies with this son, my oldest son, and this girl says, hi, Ted. Turn around, and it's Janet. And I say, Janet,
no,
tell my son that we know
no
each other.
Way.
And he's like, oh, Dad, oh, Dad. But yeah, so that was fun.
That is
it was fun.
Fun.
Yeah. So she's a sweetheart, by the way. Very sweet girl, very shy.
Mm-hmm.
And Catherine,
her mother,
came on the cruise, and she didn't want to come out of the cabin because Michael was so hot at that time. Mm. People wanted to gawk at her.
What year are we talking about? Are we in the 80s?
Yeah, we're in the 80s. Okay. When Michael was like, I think it's around Thriller, the time of Thriller or something. He was just so hot.
Yeah.
But celebrities wanted to gawk at her. I mean, we had guest stars that said, when's Catherine coming out of the thing? And so what she did was, she liked to do jigsaw puzzles. Mm-hmm. And when I went on cruises, I liked to do jigsaw puzzles. So I would sit up in the cabin with Catherine and Janet, and we'd be doing, does this piece go? That's what we'd be doing. So, Ted, what's she like? She said, she's very nice, you know.
Okay.
Yeah.
So then after The Love Boat, and you've had this phenomenal success, do you think, hey, I'm going to go on to do even bigger and better things? And then what really happens?
I thought I was going to be like a light romantic comedian. In other words, mm-hmm. you know, movies where there was some comedy in it and I mm-hmm. would have maybe a romance or something like that. And it just didn't happen. The whole thing started to close up. But because I had directed all of these television shows, that door opened. So they let me go on and I would direct Fall Guy and Mike Hammer and all these different television shows.
And you even directed Moesha, right?
Moesha, yeah. I directed. Because the acting world, the door just kind of closed. And there's if they don't want you, there's nothing you can do. There's nothing you can do. Or if they don't find you funny and you're going up for a sitcom, they're not laughing. And so what I started doing was I started directing, I started writing plays.
Okay.
And one of the things I found when I was going up for parts is they say, how tall are you? I say, I'm 5'7". Tall enough. And I said, what are you talking about? Well, he's a cop. I said, does he carry a gun? They go, yeah. He carries a gun. I said, well, hell, have me pull him the gun. They say, yeah, well, he gets in the fist fights. I said, well, I'm from Oakland. You see any scars on my face? I got in a fist fight. What are you talking about? So they go, no. We want Danny Glover. We want a big guy, you know. So it segued into directing television and directed a couple of independent features. And then I started writing plays. And my first five plays, a black character enters 5'7". That's the opening.
You wrote for yourself, right?
I wrote for myself, you know, and comedies.
Right. So let's talk about George Washington's Boy. I mean, you've written, what, 24 or so plays?
25 plays.
Okay.
25 plays, 3 musicals.
And it's Black History Month. The fact that you're writing these historical characters, that little known characters that we know
I call
not very
myself
much about.
A footnote historian.
Right.
Because if you go through white history, if there's somebody black in some event, he's a footnote.
Right.
And so what I do is I then research that person and I take the footnote and put it on the page. So I found out about a guy named William Lee,
mm-hmm.
and William Lee was George Washington's favorite slave. Now, what in researching him, I found out I was too old to play him. But I also found another character named Oney Judge, who was Martha Washington's favorite slave, and their cook was a guy named Hercules.
Mm-hmm.
And there's these stories about these three African Americans that are fantastic.
And is it hard to find information about these characters?
Yes, it is. Yeah. If you look in my book, I just want to show you this. You'll see my bibliography. So I've got to go through like a whole bunch of different books to find one thing here, another thing there, and then you start piecing that together, and then you get some more, and then you get some more. And so, because they're footnotes.
Give us a story. Just give us an excerpt of George Washington.
Okay, I'm going to tell you a wonderful story. There's a guy named Hercules who was a cook. I don't want to tell you about William Lee. I want you to come see the play, so you'll come and see about William Lee.
In Falls Church.
Yeah, in Falls Church.
February 18th.
Episcopal Church. And so Hercules is this guy. He was George Washington's cook. And George Washington, there was a thing in Philadelphia that if you kept a slave in Philadelphia for more than 6 months, they could get their freedom. Okay, so George set up a rotation.
Mm-hmm.
Every 5 months, they would rotate slaves out so that when they came back, the clock started again. Okay, so he could, so that his slaves would never, you know.
Him.
So Hercules found out about this and he goes to Washington and he says, hey, how can you do this?
Mm-hmm.
He says, I'm cooking for you, and I, you're my master, and I'm. He said, yeah, but you, Washington says, you might want your freedom. He says, I would never want to take my freedom from the president of the United States. You're the president of the United States,
mm-hmm.
and I'm here to serve you. And so he says, let me stay here.
Mm-hmm.
So Washington says, okay, you can stay here. So he doesn't rotate Hercules. Everybody else he rotates, and at the end of the second term, Washington's going to go back to Mount Vernon, and he sends Hercules ahead of him. He says, listen, you go back to Mount Vernon and make sure everything is right with the kids. And so when I get there, 2 weeks later, Washington shows up. He says, tell Hercules to, they said, Hercules?
Hercules gone. Hercules. He hightailed it out of there.
Hercules is gone, and he's got the law on his side. They never found him.
Wow.
They never found Hercules. Because, and so he says to William Lee, he said, you promised, William Lee says, you promised Master Washington that you wouldn't run. He said, I promised Master Washington as long as he was president, I wouldn't run. And he ain't president no more, so I'm out of here. I'm baking him a cherry pie, and that's the last good cherry pie he's ever going to eat. And boom, he was gone.
So being here at Howard University, they have a phenomenal theater department. And you have these young actors and actresses coming up. What advice would you give them?
It's not as complicated as some people think. It's real simple. Be on time, know your lines, hit your marks. What does that mean? Be on time means you can't be doing drugs.
Uh-huh.
You can't be late to the set. You can't not do your homework and not when you get there to the set and say, what's my line? What is that? No, you got to do your homework and then hit your marks. If you can hit your marks, which is sitting in the right chair, moving in the right way, so on, you save them time.
Mm-hmm.
If you save them time, that becomes your reputation.
Okay.
Your reputation is you're on time. So when I say be on time, that doesn't mean at 10 o'clock call, you're there at 10 o'clock. You're there earlier.
Mm-hmm.
When I came here, I was here earlier than what I had to be. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
No, that's what you do. And all the things that interrupt that will become your reputation. Mm-hmm. So sometimes black actors will see white actors acting up and they think that they can do that.
Different set of rules,
that. Yeah, they can't do that, you know? So you just know this. And the other thing is persevere.
Right.
Never, ever give up, because there's somebody that's going to like you and there's somebody that's not going to like you.
And I would say don't burn bridges, right, in Hollywood?
Well, some bridges have to be burned, but you don't have to burn all of them.
No.
Sorry. But no, because sometimes I would say I've burned some bridges. Mm. You know, I have burned some bridges. But there's some other bridges that are really strong, mm-hmm. reinforced, and you know, it's you. It's on the inside of you. Mm-hmm. You know, who are you? You know, like there's been some times where some white hierarchy guys have insulted me, and then so I insulted them back with wit.
Right.
Okay. Now they didn't. They just insulted me, but I use wit when I
you
insulted
didn't cuss
them.
Out. You just use wit.
Yeah. You know, but I don't think I would have liked myself if I hadn't insulted them with wit.
True.
And so I gotta like myself. So I know I'm not gonna do the show anymore, but I have to tell you, you are one ugly son of a gun. You know, but I know that's not gonna come back. Now, I know that maybe I shouldn't have done that, but I like who I am.
We gotta talk about the Oscars.
Okay.
This year we've got some great films. Hidden Figures, Fences, your thoughts, and then we have some great actors that are up for some
big Fences. You know the story about Fences, why Fences didn't get made for so long?
No, I mean, obviously it was a play forever, but no, what took it so long?
You were talking about Hollywood and how things go in Hollywood mm-hmm. for black performers. Mm-hmm. I'm not calling it racism. I'm just saying that how some things go for black performers. Paramount Pictures bought Fences for Eddie Murphy. Okay, they wanted him to play the son. Eddie was really hot. The writer, August Wilson, said, and he had a stipulation in all of his plays, he wanted black directors. Mm-hmm. So if you did an August Wilson play, a black director had to do the play. Mm-hmm. And so there were some white theaters around the country that said, well, we don't know any black directors. So August would send them a list of black directors so that your theater company would start to open up some doors for some black artists.
Right.
Anyway, Paramount buys Fences. They don't realize there's a clause in the contract that says you gotta have a black film director. And so they go back to August and say, we don't know any black film directors, but we got this white guy that's really good. Mm-hmm. And August said, well, you better find somebody black because it ain't gonna happen. Mm-hmm. And he stuck to his guns on that. Denzel Washington directed that movie. Mm-hmm. And there are subtle things in that movie. There are nuanced things in that movie that a white director would not know. But as a black audience member, you sit and you watch it, you see the things. Well, that's the same thing with like George Washington's Boy. I got a couple of plays where they say, well, we want to do it. I said, let me come in and direct it. Because there is such a thing as nuance. Mm-hmm. So like if you watch The Godfather, there are things that Francis Ford Coppola did that Italians recognize. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't necessarily recognize everything, but I can feel the Italian-ness of the piece.
And it adds authenticity to it as well.
Yeah. So the thing is, we want to achieve our goals. We want to be in a position so that when we're telling our stories, it's so that we educate and entertain someone that would not know. Not the director coming over saying, do black people drink coffee? Well, yeah, and they drink it black. Mm-hmm. You know, no, I put cream and sugar. You know, they then rely on the actor mm-hmm. for the authenticity or for what I call the nuance mm-hmm. of who the character is. Whereas a black director gets it. The black director said, look, here's what I want you to do, so and so, so. When the guy says that, just want you to take a beat, look, then go back to your, you know what I mean?
Right.
So then when we're watching it as the black, we get it. We know, mm-hmm. how'd they slip that in there?
So what do you think the future is? Is this kind of what we will start seeing more nominations, because we remember last year there was what I call the black lash.
Yeah. No, next year there's not going to be hardly any black movies.
So it's every other year it skips a year?
No, it's not going to be every other year. It's going to be until everybody makes another stink.
Uh-huh. And you're in agreement with that, that a stink should be made.
Are yeah, you oh, absolutely.
Will Smith and Jada, do you?
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. I remember Eddie Murphy said, he was at the Academy Awards. He said, Eddie Murphy said, there should be more black people. This is Eddie Murphy way back when. Said there should be more black people doing writing and directing and so on. And the Academy got mad. He said, how dare you say that during the Academy Awards? He said, if I can't say it then, it shouldn't, you know, when can I say it? Wow. Not as a newspaper thing when in L.A. that's only going to be read by people in L.A., but no. I'm saying it when there's 100 million people watching.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, it's been wonderful to have
it's
you.
It's not over, is it?
It's almost, I can't believe it went by so fast.
I told you it was going
to
go.
And I know you got plenty more to talk about,
baby,
too. But your play, George Washington's Boy.
I promise you an entertaining evening, and that you will discover things historically that you never knew.
And that's the point. It's educational, but it's entertaining.
Entertaining,
as well.
Yeah. That's what I do.
All good. All right. Well, that's going to wrap us up for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Thank you for watching.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.